Hey everybody, it's been a while since I've made a video. I thought I'd better put something up on my channel before you guys all started to unsubscribe and leave me. Life's been really busy for me lately. I haven't had a chance to go out and do anything in my studio. I haven't had the energy. Life has been kind of kicking my rear end a little bit. But I do have a few minutes right now. I don't really feel like setting up the cameras and the lights and all the audio, and it takes a pretty big effort to make a really good video. But I'm hoping you'll settle for this screen capture video that is really easy for me to make. I've got a few minutes and I thought I would just kind of do something that I do regularly to relax, which is just kind of look at eBay. I don't really buy much on eBay, but I do like to look at some of the vintage things. So thanks to all of you that have been asking where I am and if I'm okay. And like I said, everything's fine. I've just been really busy. And I've had to adjust my priorities. And when I have to do that, my hobbies, like video making, tend to take a back seat. So I'm sure that you understand that. And I have missed making videos. But for now, let's just enjoy the time we have together and look at a few things on eBay. And I was already looking at things when it occurred to me that I should make a video. And some of the things I've been looking at are things like vintage Schwinn bicycles, like this the Schwinn Apple Crate. This is like from the late 60s, early 70s. This one's in pretty rough shape. I see a gash in the back tire, which is what they call a drag slick. The Apple Crate was a 5-speed bicycle, and there's a big gear shifter right there on the crossbar. And as was the style back then in bicycles, you had those big high-rise handlebars. Little front tire. It was all about trying to make a bicycle seem like a dragster. And somebody wants $1,200 for this bike. I don't know if that's good or bad, to tell you the truth. I never did have one of those. I always wanted one, but my parents ended up getting me a much lower cost bicycle. It was a Huffy dragster. Now the handlebars on this example are not original, because the Huffy dragster came with high rise handlebars, much like the Schwinn Stingrays. But when my Huffy dragster was stolen from the school that I went to, my parents replaced it with a Schwinn, except it was a big, ugly Schwinn Typhoon. Mine was red, and this one appears to be a 3-speed model. Mine was a single speed. And it came from an aunt and uncle that had it lying around. They didn't really want it. And I was looking at other things, my first serious dirt bike was a Suzuki RM125, and this is it right here. It's not the one I had, it's one just like what I had, same year. This is a 77. And that's how mine looked. This was a pure motocross bike. It's a race bike. Air-cooled 125cc. Not a very big engine, but still a very quick motorcycle. And the first motorcycle I rode ever, I rode mini bikes, the little welded frame mini bikes with a lawnmower engine on them. But the first real motorcycle that I really ever got to ride was one of these Honda Trail 70s. These things have become very, very collectible. It's amazing how much they go for. This person wants $5,000 for this one. And I don't know if that's good or bad. But just seeing it brings back memories. I had one of these also, a 1987 Kawasaki KTX 200. This isn't a motocross bike like the Suzuki RM. This is a kind of, it's still a dirt bike. It's not really made to be on the road. It's an enduro bike. And it's made for trail riding and hair scrambles. Different type of racing than motocross. This is more of a woods, racing on a trail out in the woods type bike. It's a 200cc air-cooled two-stroke. And this might have been the best of the dirt bikes that I had. The motocross of Kawasaki was a KX. And of course, the seat on this one says KDX, which designates it the enduro type bike. I looked for an example, and I'll do it one more time. A Kawasaki KLX. Oop, forgot the R on now. Cycle. And I don't really see one like I had. Mine was a 19. That's a service manual. Mine was a 1981, as I recall. KLX 250, which is a enduro type off-road motorcycle, except it's not a two-stroke, it's a four-stroke. But you don't really see those around anymore. No, you sure don't. And I was looking at chainsaws. I have one of these home light super easy chainsaws. Mine is pretty much the same model. The year mine was made was 1976. It still looks good. Looks a lot better than this one. And it runs really well too, though it's been some time since I've started it. I really should do that sometime. And I was looking at some vintage hi-fi equipment. And of course, hi-fi means high fidelity sound. And the Mac Daddies of collectible hi-fi from the 70s would be just about anything sold by Marantz, M-A-R-A-N-T-Z, Marantz. So if you're at a garage sale and you come across any of that 70s stereo equipment with Marantz on it, and you can get it dirt cheap like you can a lot of things at yard sales, get it. And I do love the vintage hi-fi equipment. Before I really understood what high fidelity was, though, you know, we used to think that anyone that had some speakers, these Panasonic thruster speakers, we used to think these were really neat. But the reality of it was that they were very cheap pieces of junk. Panasonic thrusters. A good pair of speakers. And there's many types. But I have a pair of these, and I've had them for a long time. And these are Pioneer HPM100s. Some of you saw one of my videos of my cat sitting atop of one of them. Mine were made in 1978, and mine are the 100 watt version, and this one's the 200 watt version. And you can tell because the base port, which is just a hole in the front panel of the speaker, has this nice silver trim ring around it. It looks white in the video, but it's really silver. And that's how you can tell the 200 watt version from the 100 watt version. These speakers have a 12 inch carbon fiber woofer. And they've got it's about a 4.5 inch mid range. And a nice little tweeter right there. But they have this other tweeter that's a piece of film. It's not a conventional speaker. It's a polymer It's a polymer film. Pioneer called it a high molecular film, or a high molecular polymer film. And that's where the acronym HPM came from. So these HPM 100 speakers really sound great. I'll probably never, ever part with mine. This pair that we're looking at on eBay is not in very good condition. Not at all. But the ones that are in good condition go for over, you know, $8,000, $9,000 and up. And like I said, you know, when I'm on eBay, I'm just kind of reminiscing usually. You know, I like to look up things that I used to have. And one of the things I used to have was a Sound Design 8-track recorder deck. And this is the exact model that I had. Sound Design is a very inexpensive, low fidelity audio. But this is one of the first separate components that I had when I first started on my journey down the road of hi-fi. I just didn't know any better at the time, but that's all I could, you know, all I could afford. But I really thought it was a pretty nice little 8-track recorder. I made many a mixtape, recorded many a song off of the radio onto the 8-track. And of course, I could listen to the 8-track tapes in my cars. He had a 1968 Chevrolet Impala, had an 8-track player in it. It was an Underdash Krako 8-track deck. My Trans Am had a factory 8-track player in it, which was pretty cool. And I still have an 8-track recorder that I still listen to. One thing I've noticed that when I'm making a video, and I've got this big microphone sitting between me and the laptop, is I do not type very effectively. Now, there's a couple of Akai GRX82D 8-track player recorders. This is the one that I currently have. And it works. And it is part of my stereo setup. And it looks pretty sweet. Very nice looking. Thing weighs a ton. It's very heavy. Before I had that one. Wow. You type the word realistic in eBay, and you come up with all sorts of bizarre searches. Let's see here. There it is right there, the 802. When I got rid of my Sound Design 8-track recorder, I went to this one, a realistic model 802 with Dolby noise reduction. I like this one a lot. About the same time, I had bought typing in an unnatural position. I'm really not this bad at typing. And that's it right there. About the same time I had that realistic 8-track recording deck, I had this realistic equalizer also. This is the same model that I had. These days I use a BSR equalizer with a spectrum analyzer on it. Someday I'm going to make a video of what I currently have as far as hi-fi goes. Maybe I can show you my current equalizer now. BSR equalizer. I think mine is an EQ3000. Yeah, that's it right there. Here's probably the best picture I can show you. Well, I can't zoom in on a picture for some reason on this one. Let's try it on this one instead. No, this one. Yeah. So this is my current equalizer. This one in this eBay auction is beat up really, really bad. Man, that thing looks rough. But mine is pristine. It's probably, it's over 30 years old, and it looks just like it did when I took it out of the box decades ago. Now, my first real cassette deck. We'll see if we can find one. I don't know the model, but if I see a picture of it, I'll recognize it. I will put the word vintage. I would be surprised to see one. No luck yet. Well, I don't see one, but I still have it. I've had it for, let's see, 36 or 37 years. It still works. Dual was a brand. Still is, I guess. I don't know. I also have another cassette deck that's actually better than the Dual. But I'm probably boring you with this vintage hi-fi stuff. Let's look at something else. What? I'm not sure. Vintage. Let's see if I can find one of my favorite cars. Well, I see plenty of car parts. It would be a 1970 Ford Torino Cobra Jet. I see a pretty nice 70 GT, but the GT isn't the Cobra Jet. Looks very similar, but the Cobra Jet had a shaker hood scoop on it, and the GT has this molded in scoop, and the shaker hood scoop on the Cobra Jet was functional, and the Cobra Jet came with a 429 cubic inch V8. I think the GT came with a smaller engine, a 351. I don't see a good example of what I'm looking at, but I do see this very nice 70 Mach 1 Mustang. That's pretty sweet. This one's got a 429 in it. Very, very nice. I'm going to look up a something I'm going to buy as a Christmas gift to give to someone this year. A case. Mini copper lock pocket knife. They go for about $50, 50, 60 bucks. I would like to have one for myself. But before I get one for myself, I need to get one to give to someone I know that would appreciate this. That's a pretty nice looking pocket knife. Some of you have seen the spinning, well, most of you have seen the spinning knife on my videos. And it's this knife right here. Well, I use the word mini, it's really small. Small Texas toothpick. Yeah, this is the knife that you see. This exact one right here, as a matter of fact. Same color. It's a small Texas toothpick made by Case. And I still carry it in my pocket regularly. And I've been wanting a green one, but don't get me wrong, I can buy this if I want it bad enough. But I have the blue one. I'd rather have the green one. But I've already got the blue one, so I guess I'll just keep the blue one. I don't, you know, it wouldn't be very, wouldn't make very good economic sense for me to buy the green one just because I like the color better. And when I'm not carrying that, I've got a nice Gerber tactical knife, but I can't remember that's it right there. Yeah, this is it. It's a Gerber Rex Applegate knife. This one's in pretty rough shape. This video is 35 minutes long at this point. I don't know if I'll make it an hour. A lot of you that are watching, if you've stuck with me this long, you've probably fallen asleep by now. Sometimes I look up things about ocean liners, especially the Queen, the RMS Queen Elizabeth, which was an ocean liner from many decades ago. I like to look at vintage photographs on eBay. There's a nice model of the Queen Elizabeth. Well, I don't know. It's not that nice, but at the time the Queen Elizabeth was built, it was the largest ship ever made. Much bigger than the Titanic, and a little bit smaller than the biggest ships of today. I'm actually going to do a video about this ship sometime in the future. There's a reason why I want to do the video on this ship, but you'll have to wait until then to learn the reason. And I think you'll be quite surprised when you do learn the reason. Vintage Chicago roller skates. My dad was quite the roller skater. And I have his roller skates. They look pretty much like this, except they have different jump stops on the front of them. But yeah, that looks a lot like them. I don't know if the wheels are wood. They might be. I used to roller skate quite a bit, and I used to wear these hand-me-down skates. I did not want to wear the skates that you rent at the skating rink. I wanted to use my own. But these hand-me-downs were what I had to use. And my friends used to kind of laugh at me for using them. And I remember I was skating along one time, and one of the wheels fell off, and all the little ball bearings kind of went everywhere. So when I was about 15, I bought my own pair of skates. Very nice skates. I forget I guess they were Chicago, but I can't really remember. But they had some really nice set of wheels. I think they called them 8 Reds. And they had Snyder jump stops, I believe. And I had those skates up until just a few years ago, and I gave them away to one of my... He was a friend back then when we were skating as kids. And he's still a friend today. And a few years ago, he was still skating. I had since quit. He had the exact same skates as me, but he wore his out. Just age just wore him out. So I gave him mine. And they were identical to his, and they were the same size, except mine were in remarkable condition. Someday I'll... I know I keep saying someday, and I imagine a lot of you are tired of hearing me say, someday I'll show you this or I'll show you that. And I do want to. Someday I will. Here's something I've never seen before in my life until just this very second. Wing-tipped roller skates. So, were these actually sold back in the day? Vintage men's roller skates. Chicago custom. Wing-tipped roller skates. They look like regular, you know, dress shoes. That's pretty neat. Pretty neat. Town that I grew up in. Had a couple of different roller rinks. Here's a example of a sticker. You would see this on like your skate case. The other roller rink was the Tanglefoot. At Riverside Park. Man, sometimes I type in the name of the old hometown and see what kind of things are being offered on eBay related to such. And usually it's just a lot of postcards like you see here. Boy, this internet connection is slow. And I'm starting to get a bit tired, so I'm going to bring this video to a close. And again, thanks to all of you that showed concern about my short absence. Like I said, I was still am very busy, and I did want to take a few minutes and post something on my channel in an effort to keep it from going stale. Sure. Yeah, there we go. Seems to be way too many postcards on here. Here's an aerial view of the General Motors assembly plant. This view would be from like 1926 or something like that. I think that's when they built that factory there. I think it was 26. 1930 is what this view is. Of course, over the years, the plant became much larger. And if any of you that know anything about Janesville know that today the plant is gone. I think it closed in 2008 or 2012 or something like that, I forgot. Yeah, but my dad worked there. and it pretty much just about killed the town when they closed it. It was a pretty big deal. Books were written about it. Lots of exposés, news stories nationally. It made national attention because of what it did to the town. But Janesville has bounced back fairly nicely. But I'm going to close it down. Close this video down. Model trains. I still have a few model train items. What we can pull up real quick. Yep. That locomotive right there. I've got that from the 1970s. I got the caboose. And some other rail cars. That's the caboose. Tyco had two different versions, two different models of cabooses. This is the one that I've got. But anyhow, tell me if you liked this kind of video. I know all we did was kind of goof around here on eBay. But if you liked it, tell me in the comments. If you didn't like it, well, tell me in the comments also. And if enough people did like it, maybe we'll do it again sometime. Until then, take care.